First of all, let us ask one question. What is there a need for prosecution? Yes, according to the law, they must be, traffickers must be prosecuted. But unless and until we are convinced that they should be prosecuted, will not be passionate about it. So I hope all of us are passionate and we are convinced that all these traffickers should be prosecuted. Yes? Yes, very good. So we have many reasons because of which they should be prosecuted. I will talk about a very few of them because there is not much time. First of all, traffickers should be prevented from operating out of impunity. Many a times, traffickers think that there's no law which binds them and nothing happens. They take it casually. As Symbiosis Professor Sir said, that you know, sometimes there is not even FIR. They don't think that FIR is needed. So traffickers think that, okay, some victims are taken out, you know, taken out from my custody, but I will get more victims and exploit them. This is a picture wherein, you know, these hutments were used to keep the victims. 22 victims were rescued out of these hutments. If you have a close look at this, there's no pointer. Okay. You know, above the hutments, there were barbed wires and they were always kept locked under, you know, there was a gate, big gate, which encloses these, which enclosed that hutment. And when the rescue took place, this trafficker said that I am a retired police and I have political connections. So he thought that, you know, actually the stakeholders who came for the rescue, they also got scared and they didn't want to take action, but because of NGO pressure and all that, you know, they have to act out and the victims were rescued. But if the accused is not convicted, then he will think that, okay, I can exploit victims and make money out of them. Second reason is break the vicious cycle. Many times when rescue takes place, the brothel keepers ask us, madam, where were you when I was being exploited? I was a victim. I was forced into prostitution many years down the line. And at that time, nobody came. And now you are making me an accused and you are prosecuting me. Yes, we feel bad for them, but it doesn't mean that, you know, you were a victim and now you can victimize others. Somewhere we need to break that cycle. And that is why this prosecution is needed. And also it protects the victims from further exploitation. If no action is taken against the trafficker, then he will go and threaten the victims and maybe he will victimize them and they may go underground. In the sense, they may be kept captivated and no one will even be able to go and rescue them next time. Also, it protects the other victims from being trafficked. Like earlier, before the amendment of Section 370 of IPC, all these sex trafficking cases used to be tried in magistrate's court. Though the punishment was more than 3 years, maximum punishment that would be given was 3 years because magistrate can punish only up to 3 years. And 3 years was nothing for the accused. And they used to think, okay, 3 years I'll be inside and then I'll come out. And again, you know, we have some instances where accused have been imprisoned for 3 years and they come out and they exploit the victims for again, you know, other victims. Now, challenges. There are, you know, prosecution is not easy. And in my introduction, you know, I have been with the IJM since the year 2007. So it's more than 12 years. So you may be having a question, how can, you know, it's like more than 12 years she's working for the cause. Only if you have passion, you can do that. So, you know, passion is must in this work. Otherwise, it can drain you out, you know. So in these cases, accused used to get bail very easily. Now we have, you know, freedom from judgment and all other judgments in which directions are given, and bail is not easy. But even if bail is granted, then what happens is they abscond and trial goes into dormant files and trial doesn't take place. The file goes into, you know, file becomes dormant file. Then at last when the accused are found or when prosecution begins, witnesses are not available because of the delay. Especially victims will not be available, and the trafficker goes just without punishment. And also there are, you know, many a times it is poor documentation. Police think that beyond three pages or beyond two pages, FIR panchanama goes, then it is too long, and then contradiction and improvements, all that happens. That is what they think. But in our experience, we have found that you have to mention each and every fact so that in the cross-examination, whatever comes out, you know, even if victim or witnesses say some things, this had happened, then the question will not arise why this was not documented in the documentation. And many a time, false facts to strengthen the case. Earlier days, it used to be, you know, the victim used to be in the room with the customer during the raid, and they'll be fully clothed, and they will not even know. The bogus customer will be instructed that, you know, you don't even touch the victim. But police will not budge. They will be like, how can you prove that it is a case of prostitution? So let us write that they were in half-naked condition or half-naked state or even compromising position or something like that. And that used to backfire. Actually, you know, it is not right. You cannot be. You are going as a, you are going to rescue them, and you can't be the exploiter, and you should not be. There are case laws against that. If you write the truth, like panchanama not being documented at the spot, write the reasons, because it is difficult to make the panchanama at the spot, maybe mob gathering or lighting is not good or something like that. And victims are to be transported to a safe place. That is the priority. So panchanama was ongoing, and we took everybody to the police station, and we completed that there. Then in the arguments, it helps you.
Is it troubling?
In the arguments, you can say that, okay, NGO had a motive. Maybe numbers or, you know, funding, all that comes up during the prosecution. And for the police, they will say, you have done a false case and all those, you know, these arguments from the defense counsels. But then you can rebut it saying that, okay, if we had the motive, we wouldn't have documented all these things here, which are weak points in our case. But we have documented it rightly because we are truthful. We are being truthful about it, and this is a true case. And we have the panchas to testify about that as well. So, you know, it actually helps you in the prosecution. Then independent witnesses. As per the law, ITPA law, independent witnesses should be from the locality, and they should be respectable. But respectability is given more, you know, respectability should be there. And if the locality, if the panchas are not from the locality, you can address it saying that from the locality, respectable pancha, you know, getting the respectable panchas are difficult. So that is why the panchas are from outside the jurisdiction or not from the locality. Mostly we have found out that, you know, the network is being untouched. Only the, you know, prosecution is against only the brothel keeper or whoever is found with the victim that night, you know, during the rescue. All others are untouched. Even if the victim says that the trafficker who brought me is my neighbor, that investigation is not done. But that is much needed. Otherwise, that cycle goes on. Only we have touched, we have removed some victims and the brothel keeper, but someone else will become the brothel keeper and many more victims will be trafficked and they will be exploited. We need to think about it and investigate in that angle. Recently, we have done a case wherein it took a lot of expertise to do the investigation to bring down the entire network. It is not that easy. But then if you focus and investigate in that angle, it is possible. And we have cracked down one network in Palghar district in Mumbai, in Maharashtra, wherein 12 traffickers are being arrested. It was through, you know, we did the bank transactions and all that, you know, mapping of that and CDR analysis and all that, because of which this was successful. No specific role is being attributed to the accused. Most of the times, many traffickers are arrested. You know, brothel keeper, maybe manager, and all the people are arrested. But in the documentation, nothing is clear. Who is who? What was he doing or what was she doing? Nothing is there. Even in the victim statement, it is not there. Then how, you know, the case against that particular accused is being proved? It's not possible. So this we learned from our experience in the, you know, in the beginning when IJM started its casework. The same thing used to happen. The raids in lodges used to happen and all the customers, waiters and managers, everybody used to be, you know, taken into custody and they were shown as accused. But they used to take advantage of that. First of all, no role is attributed to them, specific role. Maybe one or two will have specific role. Others will not have the role. And also, to frame the charges, everybody should come to the court. So what they used to do when there are 20 accused or 15 accused, 5 will come one on one date. The other 10 will not come. Then other 5 will come, these 5 will not come, other 5 will not come. So they used to take turn and the, you know, they delayed the case, they used to delay the case and thus they used to weaken the case. In the sense, witnesses and victims will not be available after a point of time. So always it is better to attribute the role and take a few accused who you can prove that they were doing this business and they were forcing the victims into prostitution. And also in the statement, in the victim statement, get the, even if on the night of the raid, if this role is not clear, okay. But in the victim statement, it has to be attributed. And also, as you know, sometimes victims do not know them by their real name. Maybe Raju, Pintu, all these, you know, pseudonyms are there by which they will be recognizing them. But then that has to be clarified. So we need to be involved in the beginning, in the during the documentation itself. Then we can, you know, make this, you know, make the cases watertight. So accused get the best lawyer. This is, you know, you may have seen this. They have all the, you know, the best of best lawyers because they have a lot of money which is made out of, you know, exploiting these victims. And these accused will have, you know, panel of advocates, like juniors, who will do research for them. So they are well equipped and very influential in the court also, court and everywhere. And when you see the prosecution, prosecutors are, first of all, not interested and overburdened. I would say they have so many briefs and everything, every facts of the every, you know, everything they'll not remember unless an NGO is there or somebody is there to brief them and push the case. That case will survive. What about the other cases? As you know, in the panel it was mentioned that, you know, some cases just fall through. Like, nobody cares. Prosecutor is busy in, you know, just the mandate. I have to do these things and I'm done. Need not, you know, because there is no accountability also. So we need to, I would say, sensitization will work. Make them passionate about this, you know, tell them what is the ground reality. Because in our work, we have done sensitization workshop for victims, so for the prosecutors, and they are doing excellent. But one thing is that we had one APP who has gotten so many convictions. Every time when he has some, you know, we don't do hand-holding. Like, we don't go to court because we know that he will do the best. He knows everything. But he needs some points, maybe like something comes in the case, some issue. So he will contact us and he will ask us, okay, I have this issue in my case. How will I address it? Do you have any case laws or something like that? We provide that. And thus he has gotten 20 convictions or more than 20 convictions for the last few months after the training. And now we hear that defense counsels have, because he is doing so well, and he actually said that, you know, he expedites the case. Like, he will keep only one case for hearing that day and he will call all the witnesses. Maybe 2-3 witnesses are examined in one day, and thus within a month or 2 months, the case, you know, gets over, like a judgment comes out. That is how he works, and it is a good strategy, I would say. But defense counsels have complained against him, and he's been transferred to an admin position. That is what, you know, sometimes they are so influential that, you know, we also should be that much powerful and influential to get them back to this. Where they should be. And briefing of witnesses and victims, very important. Yes, briefing is not allowed, I know that, but we can brief them to be truthful and how to be tactful in the cross-examination. Because sometimes victims and witnesses are so innocent that they will just say, yes, I'm a friend of police, punch us. They think that I'm a friend of police, but that will, you know, that will have different meaning. And I'm deposing because police told me to depose. Is that the real fact? No, defense counsels are smart. They are getting this information, but then we need to brief the witnesses saying that, okay, if you say this, this means this. Are you lying in the court or are you actually telling the truth? So he has to say that, yes, police called me to the court today, but I am telling the truth. What had happened in front of me, I am deposing about that. So all these things are not briefed. So in the, you know, many a times I have seen when the witnesses were not briefed in some other, you know, when waiting in the court, some other cases, they will do very well in chief examination. In cross examination, they get mostly it's like suggestions. Today you are deposing, you know, you are a liar. I put it to you that you are a liar, and liar is a very big word for us, right? Same to them. Then they think that, okay, prosecutor is not saying anything, judge is not saying anything, and others are not, you know, nobody is supporting me, everybody is proving me to be, you know, proving me as I'm a liar, but I'm not. Then they get angry, and important questions, he will not care. what are the questions put to him, because he's already into so many questions and, you know, he doesn't care, and then he will answer anything and the case is weakened. Okay. So now the good news is we have Pairavi officers in the police stations who brief the witnesses, maybe hold the Pairavi officers training, how to brief, what is important, what do we see, and, you know, do this so that in all the, because NGOs are not involved in everywhere, in all the cases, but then it will help them in all the other cases, not only trafficking cases, but all cases in general. Victim is missing. When the case comes up, as I said, you know, delay. The prosecution is delayed so much that, you know, victim is not available. She is moved on with her life and she is not, maybe if she is moved on with the life, it's a different scenario. But if victim is gone back to her native place and then she is relocated or something like that, then the victim will not be available. But then if the stakeholders are sensitized, and prosecutors will argue that way. And again, I would like to mention that, you know, passionate APP who argued, and we got a conviction just last evening. We got the information that, you know, we got the conviction in one of the cases wherein victim had turned hostile because of other these things, like she was briefed, or, you know, it was not like prosecution's fault, but then victim turned hostile, but then still the court convicted the accused. Yeah, victim is always called, you know, after significant time lapse, and then she is moved on with her life, but again she has to relive the trauma. That should not be the case. Poor statement, because victims do not know what has to be deposed. She will give her entire story about her childhood, who she played with, what she played, and what she liked, everything. But when it comes to the case facts, police have to ask those questions, because victim doesn't know what is important for the case, what needs to be brought on record. So in the statement, nothing is there. I saw one victim statement who was a minor victim, wherein she stated everything about her childhood, everything, and then she talked about the accused also. Accused used to do this, do that, do this. Everything is there. But on the night of the raid, what happened? Only two lines were written. Maybe police did it deliberately or no, I don't know. But the officer, that too, the officer, lady officer, has taken the statement. It's not even constable. And it's written that on the night of the raid at around 4 o'clock, two people came, that is bogus customer and the puncher, and we were eating food. Police came thereafter and they took us into custody. That's all is there in the statement. So deliberately sometimes, I don't think it was by mistake, maybe it is deliberately, I would presume that, and this happens. So we need to be careful before the charge sheet is taken to the court. We need to check all these aspects, whether the victim statement and other statements are corroborating, and all these, you know, true facts which are needed for the case are documented or not. Because of the social stigma also, victims do not want to testify. But then if we counsel them and tell them what, you know, if you testify, what will happen? If you don't testify, what will happen? Maybe girls like you, or we, you know, vulnerable people like you will be trafficked and exploited. Sorry, I'm going above the time, I think. I will take only 2 minutes now. So the solution will be make the watertight case. As I already pointed out, I already spoke about this. And empower the victim to tell the truth, and also make the prosecutors sensitive, and also sensitize all the stakeholders. This will be the solution, I say. Not only those points, there are other aspects also, but then I would end here. And if you have any questions.